control. We just didn't know anything about. But we thank you, Lord, for blessing us to be here. And we know that the devil hates this service, probably above all other services that we've ever done. And so he fights us and fights against it. And then one other thing that was that we had to deal with this morning was unexpected, but it had to be dealt with. And so we thank you, Lord, for leading me to deal with that issue. And Holy Father God, we individually and hopefully collectively confess our sins, our failures, and our faults unto you. For Jesus Christ's sake, please forgive us of our sins, as we from our hearts, by your grace, forgive those who have sinned against us. We pray in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and for life, health, and strength. We thank you, Holy Father God, and giving us the mind and the health and strength to be here. Help us not to take it for granted. Hallowed be your name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And Holy Father God, we praise you and we thank you this morning for your goodness, your mercy, love, and your grace. And we praise you and we thank you for salvation, spiritual, family, financial, protection and provision and life blessings that you've bestowed upon us down through the years for nearly everybody under the sound of my voice. Lord, you have brought a mighty long way, and we have come this far by faith. And most of the people under the sound of voice today, many of them have realized that they can't turn back now. And so, Holy Father God, we pray in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ that you crush and crucify our wicked flesh within us, afresh and anew, for those of us who are saved, for those of us who are born again, and fill us fresh and anew in the power, the unction, and the anointing of your Holy Spirit, to not only serve right, to not only preach right, to not only teach right, to not only hear right, but to live right, to think right, to act right, and to do right. Deliver each and every one of us, Lord, from temptation, evil, and sin. Grant us, Lord, your grace and the power of your Holy Spirit to love right, live right, think right, and do right. Deliver each and every one of us from our distresses, our afflictions, our tribulations, our troubles, our problems, spiritual, mental, physical, emotional, family, financial, legal, school, debt, college, debt, other debt, food problems, housing problems, major decisions that need to be made. Lead and guide and direct thousands and millions to make the right move for your glory, praise, and honor, for those who are truly born again and saved, and for those who are willing to confess their sins, willing to humble themselves and pray and seek your face and turn from our wicked ways and humble ourselves, repent, and get back to to you, Lord Jesus, our first love. And we get back to the basics, and we get back to the fundamentals of the Christian faith. And Holy Father God, we pray in the holy name of the Lord Jesus Christ that you'd bless and protect, Lord, our family and all other families under the sound of my voice, from ourselves today, from our flesh and from the devil, and from the demons of hell, and from evil people in the family, from evil people in the church, from evil people on the job, from evil people in the world. Place upon us the whole armor of God. Surround us with the band of your holy angels, the wall of your holy fire. And Lord, give us sweet victory today over the world, the flesh, and the devil. And help us to do your will. And Holy Father God, we also pray today that you cast out the devil and the demons of hell and the satanic demonic spirit of Judas, betrayal, sabotage and foolishness, and the spirit of the hindering spirit of sin and bias out of the lives of people, Lord, in my own family, out of the lives of people here, out of the lives of people who have that problem here and who have that problem elsewhere. And Lord, I do pray that you would drive that demonic spirit out of the hearts and minds and lives of the people who are connected to ministry across this country and around the globe. And Lord, demonstrate the power of your Holy Spirit. Fill us all who are saved afresh and anew with the fullness and the power, the unction and the anointing of your Holy Spirit. And Holy Father God, there are millions of people, as you know, hurting this morning. And Lord, we have no words. Lord, as one pastor said, he can't even love people right anymore because of the coronavirus plague, meaning he can't go and visit, he can't hug, he can't sit with, or anything like that. He even said that having funerals via Zoom is just not right. And so, Lord, we pray that you'd comfort these people as only you can, and help them to learn whatever lessons you want them to learn, and help them to turn their hearts and eyes to you, Lord Jesus, for salvation and for comfort. And we pray in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ that you would help them to turn their eyes and hearts towards your holy word for salvation and comfort. Help them to hear the gospel even today, and save their souls and change their lives. We pray for the salvation of the lost and for the revival of the saved. Glorify your holy name in all that we say and do. Lift up your holy Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, our Savior. For it is in his name we pray. And Lord, we pray also, and we add on to this prayer. Thank you for reminding me that you would heal every Christian marriage and family that wants to be healed. And even if they are separated, we pray that you would work a divine miracle and bring them back together. Lord, have the plague pandemic to break them and make them and mold them and knock some sense into their heads and help them to understand that they need one another. And even in the words of the secular Al Green, let's stay together and let's work this out and bring marriages back together. Lord, marriages that have been broken under the foolishness and false doctrine and false prophets over the past 50 years, 40 years, 30 years, 20 years, 10 years. Lord, to help people to confess sin, help people to tell the truth, help people to forgive. Lord, we pray that you would heal thousands of marriages and families. And we pray that you will help people to walk in the power of your Holy Spirit. But Lord, we pray that you would heal these families based upon stay together if they don't obey Ephesians chapter 5 and chapter 6. Lord, help them to understand that. It is no more the family that prays together stays together. It is now a family that prays together and obey together, stay together, and they prosper, and they do well, and they glorify your holy name, and they have their own family ministry, and they reach others for Christ. And I do pray in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, blast and cast the devil and the demons of hell out of every marriage and family, and help every husband be what he should be according to Ephesians chapter 5. Lord, help every wife be what she is supposed to be according to Ephesians chapter 5. And help every child be what they're supposed to be according to Ephesians chapter 6. And help everybody to understand they must do their job without it being contingent based upon what other people do. And we pray that you'll bring about instantaneous healing, peace in the family. And Lord, we realize that it'll never be perfect because we're not perfect. But it can be far better, much more productive, much more decent, much more orderly, and a family with a purpose. And Lord, we pray that you would help Dr. Lord God in heaven, we pray for the salvation of those families that don't know you as Savior. Lord, we pray that you'd work a divine miracle and open their blinded eyes and stop their deaf ears and save their souls and help them to come to the knowledge of the truth. And Lord God in heaven, forgive us of our sins as your people for not witnessing to them. So we pray to you for laborers to come into the harvest field and to reap the white harvest, Lord, with or without us. But we pray that you use us. In Jesus Christ's name we pray for our sake. Amen. Okay, we're going to go straight to the Ephesians passage, I believe it is, Ephesians chapter 6. I know that while I read this, I know that there might be one or two who might feel that I'm provoking them to wrath. Morning, because one of the reasons why I was late this morning, I had to lift some butts. That's right. Didn't feel like doing it. I gave them space.
this world ye shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. How many of you know that attitude is almost everything in life? Your attitude determines your altitude. And sometimes the parents talking is not enough. Praying is not enough. Reading the Bible is not enough with some children. Your home is a training ground, not a paper. And so, I don't think at all that they believe that I have promoted them to wrath, but they know I love them. That's the reason why I have to chastise them. But be that as it may, very timely this morning, verse 4, Ephesians chapter 6. And ye fathers, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. May I say a few words to you parents who have gotten afraid, you have become afraid of your children. As they have grown older, in their teen years and so forth, and they're taller than you, just understand that as long as they live in your house, you're in charge. And since you are in charge, and since you are held responsible by God, you better make sure you exercise your authority. You don't have to be mean. You don't have to be hateful. And whenever I have to whip some butts, it's after days of great grace, days of giving them space to repent on their own. I'm not angry with them, not upset with them. I do like Jesus. They have done well in one area. Other areas, I make a compliment about that, pat them on the back. But then I say, nevertheless, you're not doing good over here. And I would encourage you to do the same. Don't chastise your children in anger. Let a day or two go by before you chastise them for their evil. Now, there are a few occasions where you have a child who's acting devilish, and you got to, for the sake of the other children and the sake of the other family members, you got to deal with that evil right then and there, because the devil has evidently jumped on that child, and he's acting or she's acting. It's normally a boy. The old folks used to say they smelling themselves, whatever that means. But you need to go ahead on and deal with it. And if you love your children, you will not provoke your children to wrath. Okay? You need to have natural affection for your children. And if for some reason, if you don't have that, there are people. There are people who don't have natural affection for their children. Okay? I mean, they just don't. And they don't need to be chastised. They're children. I know some of you don't like this, but I didn't let my wife chastise our children down through the years because I didn't see her as having natural affection for her children. Unwilling to tell them I love you. Unwilling to hug them. That kind of a thing. Wherever that comes from, which I know it comes from the pits of hell, but family dynamics came from a hellacious family who didn't do that, or whatever. It doesn't make any difference to me, but I'm not going to let you chastise them if I feel that you don't have natural affection for the children. I was the disciplinarian. And she marvels because she tried to become their buddy-buddy. You know how some parents do in the teen years, try to become their buddy-buddy and best bud, best friend, and da-da-da-da-da. And I cut that out. I shut that down because that's evil. I did that when I was a teenager. And that's going to cause some more problems. And that's manipulation. And I didn't allow that at all. The truth of the matter is, all of our married life, all of our family life, my children have always been closer to me, and I've been closer to them than their mother. And I'm the one who had to whip them behind when that time came. And I remember, here's the deal though. If you love your children, you don't have to worry about provoking them. That's the last thing on earth you want. In fact, you would rather just have a nice, wonderful, peaceful relationship with your children. I don't know if you've seen this commercial or not, the macaroni and cheese commercial. The mother was chasing the little girl around the house trying to, you're going to eat one more bite of these green beans, one more bite of these green beans, running around the house. The mother was hollering and screaming and angry. Had a fork full of green beans. You're going to eat one more bite of these green beans. But the child was screaming and hollering bloody murder all around the house. She's trying to kill me with green beans. She's trying to kill me with green beans. I don't want no green beans. And evidently, the child reached up in the cabinet and got her some instant macaroni and cheese. You know how children love that macaroni and cheese in the box. We loved it when we were growing up. That macaroni and cheese in the box. I forget the name of Kraft macaroni and cheese in the box. I'm telling you. Melt in your mouth and don't have some butter to go along with it. And so the next scene was they were sitting around the table and the little girl was smiling and the mother was smiling back, having been manipulated and controlled and dominated by her sweet little daughter. Now is she sweet? So I don't recommend that. In my household, we never had that problem. I had a son who, when he was a little boy, he couldn't stand okra. I loved okra. We had okra all the time. He would put okra in his mouth. This is my oldest son, and y'all know how slimy okra is. He would put it in his mouth, and I would tell him to eat it, and he would poke his mouth out with the okra and everything. But he got over that real quick, like. And I didn't get any macaroni and cheese, but he ate that okra. And ever since then, all of our children, they ate really everything we put before them. They may take a while, but we never really had that problem. Because they knew, that's another thing too, they need to know that you love them, but they need to know also that you don't play. When it's time to, when the rubber meets the road, you don't play. And they need to know that. And believe it or not, deep down they want that in their lives. They want somebody who's in control. And so, if you love your children, you don't have to worry about provoking them to wrath. If you love your children, you will chastise them. You will rebuke them. You will not let them have their way because you're not helping them. You're just not helping them. So our devotional passage today is Psalm 36. The transgression of the wicked saith within my heart that there is no fear of God before his eyes. For he flattereth himself in his own eyes until his iniquity be found to be hateful. The words of his mouth are iniquity and deceit. He hath left off to be wise and to do good. He deviseth mischief upon his bed. He setteth himself in a way that is not good. He abhorreth not evil. Do you abhor evil? Have you grown to that point in your Christian life that you abhor evil? You don't like evil in your life, and you don't like it in your family. You don't like it in the world. Thy mercy, O Lord, is in the heavens, and thy faithfulness reacheth unto the clouds. Thy righteousness is like the great mountains. Thy judgments are a great deep, O Lord. Thou preservest man and beast. How excellent is thy loving kindness. Have you ever experienced the loving kindness of God? See, there's some things that God has that we don't have. Loving kindness is one of them. Long suffering is another. We don't have it. Yeah, loving kindness, that's a whole lot of love. And God showed us that for years before the plague. We took him for granted. And now we're in a mess. That's getting to Dr. Fauci. It's getting worse, just as it has been predicted. O God, therefore, the children of men put their trust under the shadow of thy wings. They shall be abundantly satisfied with the fatness of thy house, and thou shalt make them drink of the river of thy pleasures. For with thee is the fountain of life. In thy light shall we see light. O continue thy loving kindness unto them that know thee, and thy righteousness to the upright in heart. And I think we're going to stop right there at verse 10. And I think you get the message. We'll read the 11 and 12 on tomorrow. And right now we're going to go through, or rather go to, praying for those family members that have lost loved ones in the coronavirus plague. We're going to pray also for fellow believers. We're going to pray also for the government and those in authority and everybody else as God commands us to, according to 1 Timothy. According to 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 and 2, I exhort therefore, first of all, supplication, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings, and for all that are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and honesty. Holy Father God, we pray in the holy name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, we pray for all of your people called by your name. Lord, you know who we are. And if we're born again, we know you through Jesus Christ. But we have sinned against you in the church. Even some of the most liberal pastors acknowledging that in the church we have sinned against you. Some who, and I'm so thankful to you, Lord, for this, some who were a part of the sin and leading others to sin have included themselves and have been honest in their confession. And we give you the glory, praise, and honor for the moving of your Holy Spirit in this way. Oh, Lord, this is how we ought to respond. Whether we were involved or you will accept the individual. Lord, if others won't go, if others won't do this, those few who will, you will bless them and keep them, protect them from the plague, and provide for them and protect them. And Holy Father God, we praise you and we thank you. All of us, we praise you and thank you for salvation, spiritual, family life, protection and provision blessings down through the years, and your special right hand of blessing. And Holy Father God, we know that you delight in blessings. You would rather bless us right now. But we have taken you for granted. We have taken your loving kindness and your grace and mercy and love for granted. We have marginalized you. We have pushed you to the periphery. And we have disrespected you and dishonored you in the world. And we have disobeyed you across the board. We've disobeyed the Great Commission, the Great Commandment. We've disobeyed you regarding divorce and remarriage. We have disobeyed you by allowing homosexuals to become members of the church and pastors, ministers, choir directors, and everything else in your church. When you destroy Sodom and Gomorrah for such activity, because it is a demonic attempt to turn your world upside down and to do away with depopulation. And so, Holy Father God, I pray in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ that you'll help all of us to confess our sins and to repent and to be honest. So, Holy Father God, we pray, Lord, for everybody in government, from the president on down, all governors, all mayors, all police chiefs, all sheriffs, and everybody who works under these people, city council. We pray, Lord, for salvation and spiritual family life, protection and provision blessing upon these ministers. These are your ministers as well, working in the government. We pray, Lord, that you will give them wisdom, knowledge, understanding, and insight. Be God and direct them in the way that you want them to go in their capacity. Lord, we pray that you will bless us, Lord, once we repent and turn from our evil ways. And if we don't repent wholesale, the way that you want us to do, Lord, continue to help and bless those who have. Holy Father God, we pray for all other governments in the world. We pray first and foremost, we pray for Israel now that they are going back to the quarantine type situation because of the outburst of cases, outbreak of cases in Israel. We pray for the peace of Jerusalem. We are having outbreaks across this country, even in the summertime, as was predicted. And, we pray that you would lead God in the red government officials around the world. Pray in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ that you would indeed save those who are lost in this country, around the globe, and in the media. We pray for the revival of those who are saved in this country, around the globe, and in the media as well. And Lord, I pray for all of those families lost loved ones. Some families have lost multiple loved ones from the coronavirus plague. They say over 110,000 people. Lord, we know that it is more like over people to die in their family that they couldn't even say goodbye to properly, could not bury properly, didn't know and don't know where the body is to even say goodbye in that way. So, Lord God in heaven, comfort these people as only you can. We pray for the family, friends, and church family of Ohio Pastor Delbert Williamson. We pray, Lord, for the family, friends, and church family of New Jersey Pastor Julio Guzman. We pray, Lord, for the family and friends and church family of New Jersey Church Choir member Paddy, P-A-D-D-Y, McNichol. We pray, Lord, for the family and friends and church family of Massachusetts church member Rita T. Favuli. And Holy Father God, we pray that you would comfort these people as only you can. We know that you're able, and we pray that you would help them to turn their eyes and their hearts and their spirits towards you, Lord Jesus, for salvation and comfort, and towards your holy word for salvation and comfort. Because we have no words and we have no comfort to give these people in this out of the ordinary situation, but prayer. And so, Lord, we're praying for them and to you, and that's all we can do. We pray, Lord, for the family, friends, and church family of Pennsylvania church member Charles Aaron. And Lord, I pray for the pastors of all of these thousands of folk. I know their hearts are breaking and their hearts are burdened down. Lord, give them the strength to minister your word, to give last messages, sermons, for funerals, words of comfort as only you can give it to a pastor, and help them to work 7 days a week ministering to their people via the wonderful technology that you have wrought. We pray, Lord, for family, friends, and church family of New York nun Georgiana Gloss. We pray, Lord, for the family, friends, and church family of Pennsylvania nun Irene Loretta Cassidy. We pray for the family and friends of Pennsylvania real estate owner Charles David Johnson. We pray for the family and friends of Ohio veteran Michael J. Seary. And we pray for the family and friends of Ohio resident Henrietta Tenney. And we pray these same prayer requests, Lord, upon the millions of family members and friends, even though thousands, they say, have died, millions of family members and friends and job co-workers are hurting today. The left behind are hurting like never before. And Holy Father God, we pray in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We found out yesterday that one of our prayer request receptacles was down. I hope that it has been put back up. Is that correct? Needs to be fixed immediately. Lord, we pray for Henry. Please bless him with money to buy church land, to build a church. We pray, Lord, for Paul. Please provide for him, his family, and the ministry. Protect them from the coronavirus and bless them with the supplies they need to help the people around them. Provide all people in Bangladesh with the necessities they need, and stop the coronavirus from spreading in Bangladesh. Lord, we pray for Nita, for her tonsil surgery to be a success, work a miracle, and heal her tonsils. We grow her bone and gum tissue, heal her of kidney cyst infections, and diverticulitis in her intestines. and heal all other problems and pain in her body. Protect Nita and everyone else from the coronavirus and any other illness, and have the coronavirus to lead to countless salvations all over the world as well. We pray for William, for his mom, Carol, to be healed and help her to feel better. For everyone else who has the flu or coronavirus to get better as well. We pray for Naeem, remove the coronavirus from the world and provide all people living on daily wages with the necessities that they need to survive. Provide Naeem's ministry with supplies to help others as well. We pray for Robbie, please remove the coronavirus from the world and provide him with soap, tissue, sanitizer, mask, and food to give to the poor children. Bless him with Urdu Bibles and children's Bibles, sewing machines, and tables for the widows, food for the orphans and disabled children, and food packages for the poor and needy families in Pakistan. Bless their prayer meetings and gospel outreaches as well. We pray for Stephen. Please bring his wife back from Europe, guide them in their marriage, and protect them from the coronavirus as well. And Holy Father God, we pray for all of these people. We pray and we commit them into your hands. Let your will be done in their lives and in ours. And now, Lord, we pray for the people who have gotten saved through the ministry and through the preaching of the gospel here, and those who have rededicated their life through the preaching of your holy word. We pray, Lord, for Joshua. We pray for Shirley. We pray for Happy. We pray for Donna. We pray for Mercy. And we pray for Rose, and we pray for Vivian as well. We also pray for those who have rededicated their life to you. We pray for Subda, Dami, Bobby, and we pray, Lord, for Patience, Rodwell, and Oyewo, as well as Abir. We commit these souls into your hands. Let your will be done in their lives and in ours. In Jesus Christ's name we do pray, and for his sake. What drives you? Part 4. Our devotional reading is titled, What Drives You? Part 4 from The Purpose-Driven Life by Dr. Rick Warren. And that's the guy that I was thinking about earlier. I pray that he would write a book titled The Purpose-Driven Family, because many families think that family life is just about having fun in America. But God puts families together, I believe, to get things done in the world. And so Dr. Rick Warren says many people are driven by materialism. Their drive and their desire to acquire becomes the whole goal of their lives. This drive to always want more is based on the misconceptions that having more will make me more happy, more important, and more secure. But all three ideas are untrue. Possessions only provide temporary happiness because things do not change we eventually become bored with them and then want newer, bigger, better versions. The new Cosmel wears off, and so does the excitement about the new car. The new car goes from a shiny new object that we're so excited about to simple transportation in a few days. It's also a myth that if I get more, I will be more important. Self-worth and net worth are not the same. Your value is not determined by your valuables. And God says the most valuable things in life are not things. The most common myth about money is that having more will make me more secure. It won't. Wealth can be lost instantly, as so many people have found out in this plague, through a variety of uncontrollable factors. Real security can only be found in that which can never be taken from you, your relationship with God. And by the way, do you have a relationship with God? Do you know God for yourself? And does He know you in a personal way, a salvation way? Dear friend, if you do not know Jesus Christ as your Savior, Jesus Christ said Himself in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." For God so loved the world. That means that if you live in this world today, God loves you. That's right. God loved and loves George Floyd. And God also loves the man who killed George Floyd. If you're in this world, God loves you. You may not love either one of them, but God loves all of us, regardless of what we have done and who we have done it with. God loves us. Red, yellow, black, and white. We're all precious in God's sight. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. Jesus Christ was referring to Himself. Jesus Christ came to this earth as God's Son, suffered, bled, and died on the cross for our sins, was buried and rose from the dead early one Sunday morning by the power of God. And all we have to do is believe on Him, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son as a sacrificial lamb the sacrificial lamb of God, who has taken away the sin of the world for everybody. And all we have to do is believe on Him, that whosoever believeth in Him. That word whosoever means you. That word whosoever means anybody at any time in history who believes on the Lord Jesus Christ should not perish, but have everlasting life. That phrase perish is referring to eternal hell, the eternal burning hell. Jesus Christ preached more on hell than any other prophet in the Bible. Jesus Christ preached more on hell than He did about heaven. Jesus Christ said, "In hell the worm dieth not and the fire is not quenched." He said about hell that it is a place of weeping and wailing and grinding of teeth because of the pain. Have you ever seen anybody gritting their teeth, grinding their teeth together because of pain that they're receiving? It will be like that in hell for all of eternity. Because God hates sin and God cannot look upon sin. And He created us and gave us everything, died for us. And if we reject that, if you reject Christ today and you never trust Him as Savior, dear friend, I'm here to warn you that the real you, your eternal soul, will suffer in hell for not only 1,000 years, but 1,000,000 years. Not only 1,000,000 years, but 1,000,000,000 years. Not only 1,000,000,000 years, but 1,000,000,000,000 years. There's no hope once you go to hell. And the saddest aspect of hell, dear friend, and I'm not trying to scare you, I'm just stating facts, biblical facts. You believe what I just read to you, that Jesus said in John 3:16, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. You believe that, don't you? You believe Jesus said that, don't you? You like that part, don't you? Well, He also said in hell, it is better for you, regarding hell, it's better for you to cut off your feet, cut off one of your hand, cut off your hand and a foot and go into life, into everlasting life, maimed, than to go to hell with both feet and both hands. That's how bad hell is. That's how serious Jesus was about it. So I'm not trying to scare you. I'm trying to help you. Now, by the grace of God, I'm saved. I believed on Christ. And by His grace, I don't deserve to go to heaven, but I'm going. And God has me here to help you to go as well. And so, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, dear friend, in your heart, and you shall be saved. Don't perish in hell forever. And that word perish does not refer to annihilation. You will not be annihilated. You will knowingly suffer for eternity, according to the Holy Bible. Your unbelief does not change the fact. And you can trust Christ today and be on your way to heaven. For Romans 10:9-13 says, very simply, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth of the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised Him from the dead, you shall be saved. Saved from what? Saved from eternal hell. Do you think that God in the flesh is going to die, suffer, and be humiliated before the world and die? God Himself, Emmanuel, God with us. Ultimately, God died for your sins. He put Himself on the cross. That's how much God loves you. You think He's going to do that and just to save you from being annihilated? Poof, you're gone forever? No. You must understand, God breathed into you the breath of life and made you a living soul. That part cannot die. So you need to, if you want to be wise and smart, you need to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. You might be on your deathbed. You might be on your sickbed. You might have recently started coughing and feeling sick. Many people are dying. And you need to understand, dear friend, that we all are under this threat of death. Any one of us can die at any time because of this plague, the coronavirus plague. Verse 13 says, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." Saved from what? Saved from hell. And if you'll allow me, saved to what? Saved to heaven. To be with God, to be with Jesus Christ, to be with the angels, to be with the people of God, and to walk on gold so pure that it is like transparent glass. You've never seen gold like that before. So it's going to be a wonderful time that we don't deserve. But Jesus Christ paid our sin debt. And yes, all you have to do is believe on Him. You don't have to be in church. You don't have to join a church. You don't have to give me a dime. In fact, you don't have enough money to pay for this salvation. You don't have to give any preacher any money. You don't have to run around the church. You don't have to raise your hand. You don't have to shake the preacher's hand. You don't have to do any of that. You don't have to sign a card. You don't have to do great work for the church. All you have to do to be saved, hear me and hear me well, is believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, believing in your heart that Jesus Christ suffered, bled, and died on the cross for your sins. And then just call on His name and pray and ask Him to save you. And He will save you. And all you have to do is do that one time. Don't have to call on His name a million times to be saved. He can hear you. If I can speak to over 10,000 people, 20,000 people, with the technology we have right here, and it's all recorded on Periscope and Facebook and live podcasting, and I can do that live, God can hear your prayer. He can hear your call. He can see your heart believing on Him. And so you can be saved instantaneously today. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, dear friend, and be saved today from that awful place called hell. Follow me in prayer. Repeat after me, phrase by phrase. And mean it from your heart, believing in your heart on nobody else and nothing else but Jesus Christ. Holy Father God, I acknowledge that I am a sinner and that I have done evil in your sight. I have broken your Ten Commandments. To name just five of those commandments that I have broken, Lord, I have lied before. I have stolen things before. Lord, it may not have been anything big, maybe some change out of my dad's change jar or a pen on the job or somebody's food in the refrigerator or a cookie out of the cookie jar, but I have stolen before. I have lusted in my heart after people and things before. I have dishonored, disrespected, and disobeyed my parents before. I have dishonored your name by taking your name in vain and sometimes even with cursing. For Jesus Christ's sake, please forgive me of all of my sins. As I now believe with all of my heart, the best way that I know how, on the Lord Jesus Christ, I believe in my heart that He suffered and He bled and He died on the cross for my sins. That He was buried. And then on the third day, early one Sunday morning, He rose from the dead by Your power. Lord Jesus, please come into my heart and into my spirit and save my soul from hell, which I deserve. And please save my soul to heaven, which I don't deserve. Fill me with Your Holy Spirit, Lord, and help me to truly repent of my sins past. And help me to turn from my evil life and to follow You, Lord Jesus, in the new life. For it is in Your name I pray, and for His sake. Amen. Dear friend of mine, if you just trusted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and you prayed that prayer with me and you meant it from your heart, I declare to you that based upon the Word of God, you are now saved from hell and you're on your way to heaven based upon the Word of God, the Holy Bible that I share with you today. So, dear friend, welcome to the family of God. If you prayed that prayer with me and believed on Christ, I want to congratulate you on doing the most important thing in life, and that is believing on the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. For more information to help you grow in your newfound faith in Christ, please go to GospelLightSociety.com. and read my book titled, What to Do After You Enter Through the Door. You can download the book free of charge. Jesus Christ said in John 10:9, I am the door. By me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved and shall go in and out and find pasture. Until next time, my beloved, may the Lord bless you and keep you, is my prayer. Please continue to pray without ceasing. And by the grace of God, if the Lord should tarry His coming and we live, I'll be preaching the weekly Wednesday night message, the weekly Wednesday message, in about 20 minutes, because we're going to pray and sing and pray over prayer lists and everything. Before you see my face again, we're going to have a full service before I preach. The long-running but very effective series, Praying Through the Bible. Praying Through the Bible. And as Mrs. Ruby Gooding has said, this is a praying time. And you need all of the encouragement you can get to pray, because the devil hates for God's people to pray, and your flesh hates it as well. So you need all of the encouragement you can get to pray. So if the Lord will lead you to come back in about 15 to 20 minutes, please feel free to do so. If you know somebody else who needs to learn how to pray for themselves, or somebody who needs to be saved, call a Christian nurse at the hospital and text them and hold the phone up to their face or to their ear if they're in the hospital. If you have family members on their sick bed, you need to make sure they hear the gospel. Do it in a good, wise, and loving way. Don't make the people mad, but get as many people as you can under the sound of the gospel. By the grace of God, you know I'm going to preach. Whatever else I preach, I'm going to preach the gospel. Just like I just did. Very straightforwardly, I'm going to take my time and explain it to them and help them to see and to understand what is at stake. If they die without Christ, they will spend eternity in a burning hell. And eternity is a long time. This is not time for playing, folks. We need to be praying. God bless you until next time. Let's stand for prayer. Holy Father God, I give you the glory, the praise, and the honor for this very sobering standing between the living and the dead service.